won't shear. In this video, we will explain what ionic bonds are. So Dan, previously you already explained what covalent bonds are, and how they can be polar or nonpolar, depending on whether the atoms share the electrons equally or not. But then, where do the ionic bonds come in?
Ionic bonds form between atoms in which the difference in electronegativity is large enough so that one of the two atoms prefers to take charge of all of the electrons in the bond. In this case, electrons aren't actually shared between the atoms. Some atoms have such high electronegativity values or such low electronegativity values that when they form bonds, they either want all of the electrons in the bond to be close to their nuclei, or they just give up the electrons easily to the other atom involved in the bond.
Oh, okay, I see. Can you maybe give an example of an ionic bond?
Yeah, sure. Let's look at salt, normal kitchen salt, or sodium chloride. Sodium atoms are found in the third period and first group of the periodic table, and chlorine atoms are also found in the third period, but in the seventh group. Sodium, therefore, has three shells that are capable of being filled with electrons, and only one valence electron in its outermost shell, which is not yet filled. Chlorine also has three shells, but in its outermost shell, it has seven valence electrons. It's almost completely filled. The electronegativity value for sodium is 0.9, which is pretty low. The electronegativity value for chlorine is 3.0, which is pretty large. There's a difference in electronegativity between these two atoms of 2.1. In this particular molecule, to achieve a stable electronic configuration for both ions, the sodium actually gives its single valence electron to the chlorine and becomes a positively charged ion. Chlorine, which gains completely the electron, is also an ion, but it's a negatively charged ion. Once an atom loses an electron, we call it a cation. The atom that gains electrons, in this case the chlorine, achieves a negative charge. We call it an anion. Of course, there's a Coulombic attraction between oppositely charged ions, and this can result in very, very strong bonds. Ionic bonds are actually the strongest type of bond.
Okay, but if an ionic bond is really that strong, how does kitchen salt then dissolve in water at room temperature? It has to dissociate and break those strong ionic bonds, no?
Yes. I guess the way to think about it is the following. In a salt crystal, in the solid state, the ionic bond is really strong. When we add the salt to water, the strength of the bond is reduced. When we add NaCl, or salt, to water, several of the water molecules are attracted to each of these charged ions, and they surround each charged ion to form what we call ion-dipole interaction. Why does this happen? This happens because this creates a more stable situation than if the sodium chloride molecule were forming just ionic bonds to itself. We say the water molecule dissolves or solvates the chloride and the sodium ion because each ion is completely surrounded by water molecules, and effectively the charges are further separated in the solution. Now, if you add enough sodium chloride, eventually it stops dissolving. And that is also the result of the fact that there's only so much space to put each individual ion in the water molecules, but if the concentration of sodium and chloride ions get high enough, then it turns out that forming ionic bonds is more favorable than diffusing the charge.
Okay, I see. But then, when I think of the cell, does that actually mean that ionic bonds are less strong in the aqueous environment of a cell?
That's an interesting question. It's true that cells are filled with water, and that sometimes ionic bonds break when ionic bonds are dissolved in water. The reason why they break, we said, is because the water can solvate the local point charges on each of the ions. If the concentration of these individual ions gets really high, however, then the individual ions are forced to be so close together that the water molecules can no longer independently solvate these ions. And under that situation, at high concentration, ionic bonds form stably, even in water molecules. In a couple of lectures, Professor Losek is going to begin to talk about the molecule DNA. DNA is a negatively charged polyanionic molecule. DNA is wrapped by proteins called histones, and Rich will talk a lot about the importance of packaging DNA to allow it to fit inside a little cell. In order for the histones, or protein, to stick to the DNA, the histones are positively charged. If ionic bonds were not strong in water, you could never wrap the DNA molecules into tight bundles along with the positively charged histones. So this is an example where sometimes the concentration of ions in water can be so high that it forms strong ionic bonds, even though these molecules are dissolved in water.
Super interesting, Dan. Thanks.
Unfortunately, life is not so simple.